Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it. And his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For he is our God.
Good morning, PRC. If you could all stand to your feet and worship with us.
People. the book of Revelations, we read that around the throne, there are angels singing, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come." The verse goes on to say that thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. We are his creation. And this morning our prayer is that not only would we have a service that we call encounter, but that we would truly encounter the presence of a holy God, that we would set him in his rightful place, the deity and the holiness of our God. As we go into our worship this morning, our songs of worship, I want to invite you to take whatever posture that you would like to in our time of worship. If that's kneeling out of reverence, if that's hands raised, if that's singing the songs that the Lord births in your heart as we go through this time of worship, if that's sitting because of your body, whatever it needs, we want to worship our holy God today. Father, we declare that you are righteous, you are sovereign, you are exalted above all. Father, we cannot stand truthfully in your presence because woe is me. Woe am I, Father, in need of your sovereignty, in need of your grace. God, we need you today, and we worship you, God, and we exalt you. We bless you today. Ben is going to lead us in a great hymn of our faith, and then we're going to join in singing. You can take whatever position of worship you would like to as he plays this for us. Church, let's sing this together, this great hymn of our faith.
Holy, holy,
you give us grace, Lord, undeserved grace. Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the sacrifice of your Son on Calvary, Lord, who made a way for us to enter into relationship with you, that made a way, Lord, for us to be able to approach your throne and to cast our cares before you. Gracious, merciful, holy God, the God that when we accept your Son, you reside in us, Father. How merciful, how beyond comparison, how bigger than my mind can comprehend, that the God that created all things would come and would live within my heart. God, that you would make a way for me to have communion, not just on the other side of this life, but God, that I would be able to walk through this life with the knowledge that you are with me. You are with us, Lord. Bible of God's favorite ones. We learn and we have learned through our childhood and even today that Moses was blessed to have encounters with Jesus and with God himself. We know that he had an encounter where he went into the mountaintop and he asked the Lord to show him his glory. And we know from that story that he could not look upon the face of God, but that his own face was changed because he had had a moment encounter with the God that we're singing about. And we know of other encounters where Moses and a burning bush, where the Lord would speak to him, and how that because it was a place of reverence that he would take off his shoes because he was standing on holy ground. And I wonder sometimes as a church and as Christian leaders if we remember or we recognize that God dwells within us, and where we go is holy and it is sovereign because God is with us. So church, as we sing this song that we are waiting for him, I believe that he waits for us. He waits for us to engage him. We're distracted by all things on this earth, but when we set our mind and our hearts and our eyes upon him, he changes us. So wherever you find yourself today, whether you find yourself on a mountaintop or whether you find yourself in a valley experience on this earth, God is here to meet with us. He is present. Let's worship him. Let's lead us.
Not by power, not
says, awake, O sleeper, awake, and recognize what God can do for us.
Right there where you're standing, or you're seated, or you're watching online, wherever you're at right now, would you just begin to pray, to call out to the name of the Lord? Would you just begin to say this name with me? Jesus. Would you say that name as loud as you can? Jesus. Would you say that name as soft as you can? Jesus. Do you know that it doesn't matter if you're saying it with a scream or you're saying it with a whisper, that all sometimes in the midst of the pain, all you can do is just whisper. Sometimes in the midst of the darkness, all you can do, when you call the name Jesus, you're calling on the light of the world to show up and to say, I need you in this moment. I need you to show me somehow, some way, you're going to get glory out of this mess. Say that name, Jesus. Can I tell you what happens when we say that name? Fear bows. Healing shows up. Power shows up. Let's just praise Him. Father, we just thank You right now, because the name that we declare is the name of a person who is among us in this moment. Father, in the name of Jesus, we're asking You, Lord, that You would manifest Your presence, Lord. Lord, physically, Lord, spiritually right now, mentally right now, emotionally right now, Father, those that are present in this room, those that are online right now, that God, that You would just manifest Your presence right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, demons begin to flee. declare the name of Jesus. Somebody who's holding the chains right now. He says, if I got up, you can get up. Hallelujah. I got up by the power of the Holy Spirit and the resurrected King resurrecting you right now. In this moment, Holy Spirit, would you break every chain? Break every chain. Break every chain right now. Break every chain right now. Break every chain. Break every chain online. Break the chains in the car. Break the chains in this church right now. Break the chains in our mind right now. Show us your glory. Show us that you got up. Show us your hands. Show us your feet. Show us your power. Show us your anointing. Show us you're victorious. Show us who you are. Chain-breaking praise right now. Give him the soul searching, the praise, the sacrifice of praise. I don't feel like it, Lord. I'm hurting, but I'm coming. I'm crying, but I'm coming. I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm coming to you, Lord, to praise you with everything that I've got. I'll bring that sacrifice of praise, regardless of what people think about me, regardless of what my family thinks about me. In my home right now, I'm going to raise my hands in victory. Somebody needs to praise me. Hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody who's victorious. Hallelujah. You've got a song that the angels cannot sing. The song of the redeemed. All they can cry is holy, holy, holy. But we can sing that from a posture of faith that says I've been redeemed. Hallelujah. Right now, God. He's a whole lot better preacher than I am. Just let him do it right now in your word.
He's here.
Just be obedient to your word. Just be obedient to what he's calling you to. Raise the hands in worship right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You are here, Lord. You are here, Jesus.
If he's ever been faithful to you, if he's ever healed you, if he's ever brought you through some things, give him a praise. Give him a praise. Hallelujah. 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 I know it's, those of you that are watching online, I know that a little bit different. Those of you that are here, maybe it's your first time, it's a little bit different. But this is called encounter. I didn't come just to share some words with you. I came to have a personal encounter. Is anybody here with me this morning? Is anybody here to have an encounter with God? Because I'm going to tell you something. If you have an encounter with God, you're not going to go back and be the same that you were. COVID's done a lot for us. COVID has silenced a lot of people. COVID has shut in a lot of people. But I'm telling you, it's not because of the vaccine that people are coming out. It's because the power of God is displaying his life, is displaying his anointing, and is saying fear has no authority in my people. Fear has no authority in my children. Is there not a scripture in this word that he has not fulfilled or will fulfill? Is there not a promise that he will not stand true to?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Go ahead. Hallelujah.
You are here, working in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're working in this place. I worship you. I worship you.
Let's sing this together.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you.
Since that time, he's been in pain in his lower back, his leg, his extremities. We believe that we serve a way-making God. Amen? We know that there are times that God causes us to be still. And I want you to know I'm not out of order because I already asked Pastor if I could do this. I don't interrupt a service unless I feel that the Lord is prompting that. So with permission, I'm going to lead us in a prayer for him. The Lord sometimes allows us to step away from our hectic life to be still because he wants to speak to us. And there are moments that we don't understand why that happens, sickness or challenges. And so Pastor, I don't know. It seemed unexpected. You're in the hectic race of 21 and 21 and so many things happening within our church and babies being born and people passing away and people needing to be visited in the hospital and your own family and your schooling, so many things. And here all of a sudden, something kind of takes you out. Unexpected, not your plan. But there's order and there's providence in the things that happen in our lives. And I believe from my own experiences that sometimes God says, peace, be still. Because I need you to be still. Because I got to say something to you that you might not hear when your phone's beeping and buzzing and you're running and you're going to and fro. And not that God wants us to have pain, but his word says we're going to, right? It says in this world we're going to have suffering and to expect it. It says that in his word. But then he also says that he comes to bring us peace and he comes to bring us life. And that by his stripes that we are healed, and that when we gather in community, there's power and there's faith that rises. And I just have enough faith today to believe that I am surrounded by people that believe in this power that we're talking about, that Jesus Christ that lives within us, that by the power of God's Son, that he can touch our pastor. And not only our pastor, I'm looking right now, and Denise was here at our conference this weekend in pain the entire weekend. Denise, his power is here for you. There may be somebody standing around you that you know is in pain. I'm going to ask the elders of our church, those in ministry, to please step forward. Let's anoint our pastor. Let's do this in according to our scripture. He says to call upon the elders that we can lay hands upon those and that they will rise up. If you have faith today to believe that God is a miracle working God, it's not just a song and it's not just a routine that we do, but I believe it. Do you believe it, church? Do you believe that we serve a miracle working God? Why does he perform miracles? He does that so we can shake off the scales of our eyes so that we can recognize the deity of who he is. That's why he performs miracles. So, Father, we believe today. We believe today for your miracle-working power. Church, let's pray. Of faith. We pray prayers of faith and a believing in a miracle working God. Hallelujah.
Darkness.
the truth and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You believe that this morning? Just give him praise if he's ever been a way maker in his life. You're being seated today. Thank you so much. God bless you today. We're so thankful. I had some who called and said that they were really upset that they had to find out that I had been in a crash from the pulpit, and not from them, from me. But it happened right out here in front of this red light, and I want to pray for the young lady. She didn't have any insurance, no license. My heart immediately went out to her, but I'm so thankful for your prayers. It's not that I did not want to not tell anybody. I thought I'd have been over it by now. Anybody ever say that? I realize I'm not 29 anymore. I thought I'd have been up by now. And I really appreciate your prayers. I also want to say thank you to Monica Luthley, to Kristen Goins, Sarah Holt, Susie Barino, Annie Baines, Tina Dasher. Can we give these ladies a hand? They did a phenomenal job making our women's conference available here at Peerless Real Church this past week. I'm so thankful. I also want to make you aware of Irma Parker, which normally sits over here, which is the wife of Lovell Parker, passed away yesterday, and the family will be traveling to South Georgia today. We want to keep them in your prayers. We're so thankful for you, so thankful for what you're doing. I appreciate Dr. Lamb filling in remarkably last week. I really, even though I had been in a crash, really wanted to be here, and that ended up being my worst day, and I just couldn't be here. You know I want to be here among you, with you. I was watching with you online. So thankful for your worship. Those of you that are watching online, I'm so thankful to Mike and Miss Tina and Mike and all of those who make media online possible. We're reaching so many people that we don't even realize. And today, if we have a title of the sermon, it is Connect with Courage. And as we understand that in this 21 and 21, how important it is for me, today we start a brand new initiative. You know, those of you, there are some of you that have not been here. You're not here. This is the first time we had some at the 9 o'clock. Maybe they were here last week, but first time that you've been here since COVID started. Welcome home. We're so glad that you're here. And we also want to just let you know that in this 21 and 21, we're moving from just having good intentions to action. And in January, we did that through prayer and fasting. In February, we did that through loving on others. We had a laundromat outreach in which we went and just pumped the washing machines. And I got a new perspective of how much it costs to go to the laundromat. But we were also able to lead a young lady, an older lady named Donna, to the Lord in the middle of the laundromat. Can we give the Lord praise for him saving? I'm so thankful for you, and as we move, so in this, understand today that it probably would have been, I had others urging me, please don't, but today I had to connect with courage myself, because it is important for you to hear from me this month's initiative, Connect with Courage. And so as we move from intention to action, I want you to understand that that PRC is called to reach out. We are here to reach, connect, to grow, and to serve. And that's the four pillars of our mission statement. And PRC is called to reach out. In reach, we will reach up to God, and we will reach out to others. But in the same way, as we're meeting with our team and looking at this and evaluating everything that was taking place, I began to realize something. I began to realize that it's impossible to grow beyond what our structural base will allow. Understand what I'm saying for just a minute. I have something that has been built. It's stronger because it has two bases. But the only way that it's supported, it'll be all right. Understand, I can't build a building with this one pillar. I can't build a fence with one pillar. And today, I want you to understand that while we are called to reach out, we cannot grow beyond what our structural base will allow. We can win so many people to Peerless Road Church, and I believe that God is going to give us favor and is giving us favor. But I'm going to tell you that if we don't have a base ourselves, we will not be able to contain its growth. So today, we'll focus on us. I've wanted to focus on us and then go out with this, but the Holy Spirit was bringing us back to us. Today, we're going to focus on us. We're going to focus on reaching within. We're going to connect with courage, and we will see the need to connect intentionally for the next 21 days. That means that within this church, within this movement, whether you're watching online or whatever, I know we have others, and I want to be mindful because we have so many people, and have a lot of people that are watching from different states and in different places. And if you're connecting with us, you're a part of us, and we're so glad to have you. But in Matthew chapter 28, if you have your scriptures, I want to talk about connecting with courage today. Matthew chapter 28, 18 through 20. And then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age." We have a vision to go and to win souls. But back in February, we talked about that vision brings victory. And then we come at the very end before last week. We come back and we zoomed in on the vision, and we took almost like a lens, and we focused in on that. And we said that focus brings freedom. So when I began to look at this great commission, which is oftentimes, many times, to go out, and I focus in on this scripture, I want you to notice on verse 19, he says, "Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit." A lot of times we see that as a mandate to go and win the lost. But if we focus in on that particular part of scripture, we'll see that Jesus is actually speaking also about the mission within the church. He's not only commissioning us to go and to win the world, but he's saying that as the church begins to be built, you've got to build the structure for growth. "Therefore, go and make disciples." Disciples don't come out ready-made. Just because you get up from an altar and you accept Christ as your personal Savior doesn't mean that you're ready to go out there. You don't go out. You have to be intentional. You have to take the next steps. And you have to continue what we call a relationship or walking with Christ. And so Jesus here is saying that the mission, if we zoom in on this scripture, he says that, focus in on the scripture, Jesus is talking about the mission within the church. To make disciples, to get them from the pool, the baptism pool, to the pulpit. Now, some of you are saying right now, I don't want to go to the pulpit. No, you don't understand what I'm saying. God is calling us to make disciples within the church. He is calling us to connect within the church. He is calling for us to come together within the church, share life within the church, share defeat within the church, share victory within the church, share joy, share tears, share life, share everything within the church. And as we begin to go from the baptismal pool and somebody comes alongside of them and they begin to mentor, they begin to bring them under their wing, then God is moving us from the baptismal pool to the pulpit, the lifestyle evangelism. Leonard Ravenhill made this statement. He said, "The only reason," an evangelist of the 1900s, "the only reason that we don't have revival is because we're willing to live without it." I want to say it again. In the state that we're in, with everything that has gone on over the past year, are we content to live where we're at? Are you content in your relationship with the church and with your community of faith? The only reason that we don't have revival is because we're willing to live without it. Nehemiah One of my favorite verse chapters of scripture or books. I want to read that. In the month of Kislev in the 20th year, while I was in the citadel of Susa, Hananiah, one of my brothers, came from Judah with some of the other men. And I questioned them about the Jewish remnant that had survived the exile and about Jerusalem. And they said to me, those who survived the exile are back in the province and are in great trouble and disgrace. He said, the wall of Jerusalem is broken down and its gates have been burned with fire. In verse 4, when I heard these things, he said, I sat down and I wept. And for some days I mourned and I fasted before the God of heaven. And then I said, Lord God of heaven, the great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments, let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. He says, I confess the sins that we Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We've acted very wickedly towards you. We've not obeyed the commands, the decrees, the laws that you gave your servant Moses. Remember the instruction that you gave your servant Moses, saying that if you're unfaithful, I'll scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and obey my commands, and even if your exiled people are at the farthest horizon, I will gather them from there and bring them to a place that I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. And they're your servants and they're your people, whom you redeemed by your great strength and your mighty hand. Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of this your servant and to the prayer of your servants who delight in revering your name. He says, give your servant success today by granting him favor in the presence of this man. He said, I was a cupbearer to the king. Do you understand that he was number two in command? He was the most trusted official that the king had at that time, because the cupbearer would literally take a drink of the cup that was being offered to him. And if it was laced with poison, then guess who what would happen to the cupbearer? And so when he said, I was a cupbearer to the king, he wasn't just saying, I held a cup. He was saying, I had authority. I had trust. I had a place of authority. I had a place of significance. But yet in the middle of the situation, can I tell you that what happens right now is, as we begin to look at the state of our churches and we look at the state, and I'm not talking about our local church, I'm talking about the church as a whole. The enemy has tried to shut us down, yet here we are. The enemy has tried to silence us, yet here we are. And even with the Equality Act, I'm telling you, they'll come. I'm going to call a specific time of prayer. It is, an opportunity to try and silence. And I'm going to tell you, when the enemy throws out an attack, it is up to us. And one of two things will happen, and what happened with Nehemiah at that time. We'll either ignore it, or we'll call to God and ask him to do something about it. We'll recognize that we can connect with courage and that God can use us. I want to tell you, look at what he said. He told the Lord, he said, listen, Lord, he said, do you realize? He said, that I recognize that me and my father's house have sinned. I recognize all these things. But can I tell you that he also understood what the church doesn't know, what the world doesn't know. He understood what the world doesn't understand, in that God, we may lose some battles. We may lose some churches. Some churches may close over this. Some things may happen over this. But God is still going to raise a church in this moment that will bombard the gates of hell, and they shall not prevail against the church of God. You see, in that moment, I want you to understand, as he began to see and began to recognize the dire situation that they were in, he connected with the courage. He connected with the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the same anointing that caused Caleb and Joshua to rise up and say, we are well able to possess this land. The same courage that rose up in Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. The same courage that rose up in Daniel. The same courage that rose up in Esther. The same courage that rose up in Mordecai. And go on and on and on is the anointing of the Holy Spirit that looks at a dangerous situation, that looks at an impossible situation, but sees the hand of an almighty God, that sees the breath of God, can breathe life into something dead and cause it to be raised again from the dead, that can look in the darkness and declare light to come from it. I'm telling you, we may be in one of the darkest hours, but I believe the Holy Spirit and the church of God is going to rise up, because Jesus Christ is the light of this world. Give him praise in his house. Hallelujah. He said, I recognize where we've fallen short. I recognize, more importantly, he says, I recognize where I've missed the mark in my generation behind me. But can I tell you, he says in verse 8, but remember the instruction that you gave to your servant Moses. Can I tell you, when the enemy is trying to tell you all the stuff that's going wrong, you just got to pick up the word of God and remember the promises. And not just remember them, not just quote them, not just put them, but hide them inside of your heart that you might not sin against God. See, I'm not talking about going and doing something deliberately evil. I'm saying not taking God at his word, not remembering, not taking God at the promise that he's going to bring us through in the middle of this situation. As he began to do that, he began to remind God of his power and his authority, and that he is, and can I tell you, Jesus looks at me and you and says, if I got up, you can get up too. The same spirit that raised him, Jesus Christ, from the dead is the same spirit that wants to get inside of us. So no matter how broken your situation, no matter how burnt and devastated your identity, your misidentity is, there is still a spirit of God that is operating in this world that says, I can rebuild what the enemy has torn down. I can redo. I can restore what the locust and the cankerworm have tried to destroy. We have the power of the Holy Spirit, and whatever spirit comes against us, it will fail. He remembered the power, and he remembered, more importantly, that they were the servants. In verse 10, they are your servants and your people whom you redeemed by your great strength and your mighty hand. I'm going to tell somebody this morning that you need to remember whose you are. You need to remember there's a God who not only formed you. You may have seen that I go back and I was looking yesterday at some of the ultrasounds, and I'm reminded that you may have been a fetus or whatever, but God knew who you were. Can I tell you that no matter where you're at, God sees you where you're at, and he will redeem you with his great strength and his mighty hand. But in this 21 and 21 that we're talking about, I already see it in the book of Nehemiah. Follow me for just a minute. In January, we prayed and we fasted. Nehemiah did that. In February, he loved the people enough to not just sit here and say, I'll go talk to the king. I think I'll go talk to the king. But he moved from intention to action. And he connected with courage to put his job, and not only his job on the line, but his life on the line. Because you didn't just walk up in the king's quarters unless he summoned you. But can I tell you, in March, he began to connect with courage. When we connect, the second point, if you're following along in the Bible app this morning, when we connect with courage, it becomes contagious to other people. In Nehemiah chapter 2, the Bible says that he goes before the king and he asks the king, and he says, "Will you?" And the king acknowledges that he's in a dire situation. He acknowledges that things are happening, but he begins to give him favor. And Nehemiah begins to go, and he begins to examine the wall, and he's beginning to tell the men. He pulls everybody together, and he says in verse 17 of chapter 2, "Then I said to them, you see the trouble that we are in, that Jerusalem lies in ruins and its gates have been burned with fire. But come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace. I also told him about the gracious hand of my God on me, and that the king had said to me. And they replied, let us start rebuilding. And so they began this good work. But when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official and Geshem the Arab heard about it, they mocked and ridiculed us. What is this that you are doing? They asked. Are you rebelling against the king? And I answered them by saying, the God of heaven will give us success. We, his servants, will start rebuilding, but as for you, you shall have no share in Jerusalem or any claim or historic right to it. And you hear the passion of Nehemiah. He pulls the people together and says, okay, we're in trouble. Okay, so things aren't going exactly the way that we thought they were. But he looks at them and says, listen, in the Christian Standard Version, verse 17, So I said to them, you see the trouble that we are in. Jerusalem lies in ruins and its gates have been burned with fire. But come, let's rebuild Jerusalem's walls so that we will no longer be a disgrace. And I told them how great the gracious hand of my God had been on me and what the king had said to me. And they said, let's start rebuilding. Because in the same way in Ephesians chapter 6, he tells us to put on the shoes of peace. I believe at some point in your life, you're going to have to connect with courage for yourself. You're going to have to connect in the midst of the pain. You're going to have to connect in the midst of the trial. You're going to have to connect in the midst of the doctor's office. You're going to have to connect with the midst in the midst of adversity. And even on the victory, can I tell you, if the enemy's not on your case right now, just get ready. He might. And when that time comes, you're going to need to connect with courage. But notice what happened. The Christian Standard Version puts this in, and other versions do. NIV left it out. But it says, they said, let us start rebuilding. And then their hands were strengthened to do this good work. When you and I begin to make it a point to connect with courage, the anointing will connect us with empowerment. When we begin to make our minds up that we're going to connect with courage, the anointing is going to strengthen you in areas that you were in strength. I'm a living example right now in this moment. I'm connecting with courage because I wanted to share this vision with you. But I'm going to tell you that I feel the power of the Holy Spirit. Why? Because I'm connecting with the anointing. I'm connecting with courage. And I'm feeling my body being strengthened in this moment. I love what Dr. Howard said. He prayed for me before the first service. He said he had a grandfather who was a pastor of a small church in Wyoming. He said he could barely walk, and he had so many back pains, so many issues. He said they would have to help him on stage. He said, but then the anointing of the Holy Spirit would hit him, and he would go from side to side, preaching to the anointing. He said, but I wish I could tell you that he walked off the stage. They had to help him off too. Can I tell you, the anointing will empower you for the moment. Some of us have gotten so used that we're leaning literally in the Listen, I don't know if these people had gotten to the place where they remember the anointing of yesteryear. They remember the anointing of Moses. They remember the anointing of the previous years. But can I tell you, Nehemiah was trying to tell them, connect with courage now, because there's an anointing that is fresh. There is a wind that is blowing. He says, so turn your ear to the where the wind's blowing. Put your finger in the air where you feel the wind blowing so you can see what he's doing. That's what this 21 and 21 is. You see, let us start rebuilding, and their hands were strengthened to do this good work. Billy Graham says this, when a brave man takes a stand, the spines of others are often stiffened. When a brave man connects with courage, when a brave woman connects with courage in the midst of adversity, husband walks out, wife walks out, when you're faced with situations, some of you, I know your stories, I know what's happening, some of you have been betrayed, some of you are in blissful marriages, there's so many different things, but I'm going to tell you, there's going to come a point somewhere in our lives where we have to connect with courage. Because you see, if we will connect with courage and begin, we will have the courage to reach the end. You see, when they began to sit there and began to build the wall at that moment, they began to build it little by little. Notice, they weren't trying to go at it all at once. This 21 and 21 are connecting intentionally, connecting within the walls of PRC. I'm saying that they're probably, most likely, 100% possibility that there's somebody sitting here this morning that you don't know. And God is calling us to take courage to say, you know what? I'm going to connect with them. I might be an introvert. Do you know that I'm really an introvert? You wouldn't believe that. I really was until I was filled with the Spirit. I don't walk into the room and go to the front. I go to the room, walk in the room, and go to the back corner. But I'm going to tell you, if we'll connect with courage and begin to take a step out, We will have the courage to reach thee. And notice what happens. In Nehemiah chapter 3, notice the high priest in verse 1, Eliashib, and his fellow priests began rebuilding the sheep gate. They dedicated and installed the doors. And after building the wall to the Tower of the Hundred and the Tower of Hananel, they dedicated it. And the men of Jericho built next to Eliashib, and next to them Zachor, son of Imri, built. Some of us think that it's the pastor's job to rebuild the church after COVID. Some of us think it's the pastor's job to build the church. Can I tell you the statistic I read the other day is that the charisma of a pastor and the real effect of a pastor making an impact on whether people come back to church is 6%? Ooh, that was a weight lifted. You know. I felt the anointing when I read that. I about shouted. I had to read it again. I almost wanted to tweet it, but I didn't. But they were saying, I'm going to tell you why we need you to connect. And some of us are going to think, I can connect with being on stage. Some of you, we don't even need you. There are jobs you can connect within this church, and there's things that you don't even have to say a word. There's things that you can do. But notice what happens. The high priest began it, but then the men of Jericho. So the high priest began to meet with the men, and then Zachor, a son of Imri. And then in verse 3, the sons of Hassanah built the fish gate. I'm not trying to, don't think that I'm trying to take the pressure off of me. I'm just trying to get you to understand we need to connect. We need to do this together, okay? But notice what happened. So you have the preachers building the wall. You have the others. You have the men building the wall. You have the sons building the wall. And now if you keep going on, in verse 8, after him, Uzziel, son of Harhiah. Is it up there? Y'all try getting up here and saying this. I did listen to Siri before I come up here. It don't work. But notice what happens. The goldsmith made repairs. And next to him, Hananiah, son of the perfumer, made repairs. And they restored Jerusalem as far as the broad wall. And then check out verse 12. Beside him, Shalom, son of Halohesh, ruler of the half district of Jerusalem, made repairs. He and his daughters. So do you realize what was happening when Nehemiah began to step up and began to connect with courage, and he began to get other people, and they began to say, okay, let's start rebuilding. It wasn't just a generational thing. It wasn't the older people doing all the work. It wasn't the kids doing all the work. It wasn't the youth doing all the work. It was every age of every generation, boys and girls, men and women, priests and perfumers, businessmen, different ones. Can I tell you, you and I have an opportunity to be a part of God doing something powerful in this church, in this community, in this hour, in this generation right now. And so all of a sudden, next to him, the Levites made repairs. And beside him, Hashabah, verse 17, ruler of the half district. He was saying, you know what? There were some of them that were nobles. There were some of them that were high in authority. And so you have the high in authority and you have the low in authority. You have those that matter and those that don't really matter. And I'm going to tell you something, that as we intentionally go and begin to connect inside of our local body today, I'm asking you to not simply be a part of something. I'm asking you to connect with us. Your presence right now, and some of you that are watching online, I know it's spring break this week and everything's taking place, and those of you that are watching online, I want you to understand that right now it looks like, and what we have is this, it looks like that these boards are a part of this structure, doesn't it? And maybe even your presence here this morning, hear me out, maybe even your presence here this morning says, I am a part of Peerless Road Church. Raise your hand if you feel like you are a part of Peerless Road Church. Every single hand should. Okay, I was about to say. I used to tell the youth, I would tell them that it's my job. I mean, I would tell them all the time, you have a place in this church. You have a place in the kingdom. You have a place. And now I look at them and I tell them, as your pastor, it's my job to find you a place. So listen to me. Your past does not disqualify you from connecting to the power of God. The mishaps and the missteps and the brokenness that is evident all over maybe your social media or all over your face or all over your life or all over your actions, the victimization of your life, even though you don't see it, everyone else sees the brokenness. And I'm telling you that doesn't disqualify you from God doing a miracle on your behalf. But you see, there's a difference in being a part of something and being connected to something. You see, if I'm just a part of something, it looks like I'm a part of it. It looks like it's connected. It really looks like this is a healthy, sturdy fence until something happens, until life happens. And if you're not connected within the body of Christ, if all you get in your relationship with God is a Sunday morning sermon, church, can I tell you, you're only in a partial relationship. You're in a part-time love affair with Jesus. And God is saying, I need you all in. Because I'm going to tell you what happens. There's some things in our life when life happens and when things happen. If you're not connected, you know what's going to happen? Even though you may look like you're a part of it, all of a sudden you find yourself becoming disconnected. And before long, the very thing that you were a part of, you're no longer a part of. And you're wondering, why hasn't the pastor called me? Why hasn't anybody checked on me? Why hasn't anybody done it? And it may be because you were not connected, you were only a part. But I'm going to tell you that God is calling us in the next 21 days for us to intentionally not just be a part of this church, but he's calling us to intentionally connect to this church. Now, I'm looking at you. Some of you have been active in the church before. Some of you were active in volunteer roles. Some of you were active in different things. And I'm telling you that it's time to reconnect. So if you're watching online, I'm telling you, I love that you're a part of it, but God is calling us to connect. Because nothing will, the last point I want to share with you this morning, Ben, would you come? Because I'm going to tell you something. That nothing will be impossible with the people of God when we connect with the power of God. If you will find yourself connecting with courage, if you will find yourself not just being a part of this local church, Pastor Adam, I tithe. What else do you want? Thank you for your tithes. But I want you. I want you to connect. Because it's not about growing a church. It's about the people of God connecting with the power of God to see a miracle take place in the generation in which we live in. You see, because I'm going to tell you this, in the moment that we begin to connect, notice what happened. Is the Bible says that they began to repair with all their might. And I'm going to tell you, when we begin to go, and we're sitting here trying to go at this 21 and 21, I realize I'm under attack. I realize that the enemy is coming after me. Why? Because this isn't my vision. This 21 and 21, I'm moving from intention to action. It's not my vision. I could lay down tomorrow, and because it's God's vision, he'll raise somebody up to receive the mantle and to push us from intention to action in this local church. And God is, what, say, well, who is that? It is you. I don't know what's going to happen in my life, but I'm going to tell you this, is that God is calling us as the people of God to connect with the power of God and watch a miracle take place right before our very eyes. In Nehemiah chapter 6, 15 through 16, the Bible says that the wall was completed in 52 days, and on the 55th day of the month Elul. And when all of our enemies heard this, and all their surrounding nations were intimidated and lost their confidence, for they realized, thank you so much, gentlemen, they were intimidated and lost their confidence. For they realized that this task had been accomplished by our God. Do you want to know the biggest way to shut up the world who's trying to shut the church up? Be the people of God. You know the fastest way to get the Equality Act shut down? It's to fast and pray. It's to call upon the name of the Lord. How many of you still believe God has the power to answer prayer? Listen, the enemy has sit here and said, we're not hiding it anymore. We're coming after the church. We're coming to shut it up. We're coming to do this. And I'm going to tell you something. And if we are only a part of the church, then can I tell you, it would be really easy for the church to fall down. But when the people of God begin to connect with the power of God, no matter what the enemy tries to do, we're stronger together. And he can push, and he can huff, and he can puff, and he can do all that he wants to. But the power of God is going to keep us standing. And the power of God is going to keep us strengthened. And the power of God is going to give us success in this day. And it's not going to be by programs. And it's not going to be by calling revivals. And it's not going to be calling different things, guest speakers to come in and motivate us. It's going to come when we connect with courage that God is calling us to connect one and ourselves to what He is doing in our lives. Would you come? Would the worship team come? You see, for the next 21 days, I'm asking you, and Mike, I know I forgot that video. We'll show it in just a minute. We have a video that we want to show you. It's on the website. It's Where's PRC? That's why I've got my Where's Waldo shirt on. Because we want you to take the You Are Loved cards, and we want you to take the You're Worth It cards, and as you see each other on spring break this week, or if you see each other in Cracker Barrel, or you see each other in different places, I want you to just keep those cards in your pocket. And whenever you see somebody within PRC, maybe you haven't seen them in a while, maybe you haven't done anything, whenever you encounter someone from PRC out in the community, take a picture of yourself with them. Hand each other a You Are Loved or You Are Worth It card, and don't forget to post the picture to social media. There's a 21 and 21 page on Peerless Road's Facebook. Go and connect it. I was so encouraged this week. I had several cards from several of our ladies that in this church that sent the card, and in one of them, Sister Shirley Sanders put in the You Are Loved card. I thought, I created this. But it was so encouraged laying in the bed to open it up and receive it. Can I tell you that when you connect with courage, it'll become contagious on other people? You know, there's a young couple that started attending, and they've, Brad and Monique, back here in the back, I know they love attention, so they have jumped right on in. They were here this past week with the women's conference, volunteering. Why? Why am I pointing them out? Because when they first come, I don't know their background that well. I'll learn it and join the journey. But I do know they did this. They took a chance. They took a chance to take a hold of courage and to connect with courage. And what they're finding out is they have a place to serve. And they find out that they're stronger together. Would you stand with me all across this building? If you want to see the video, stick around. We'll show it at the end. How about that? But I'm going to tell you, there is a place for you. You see, when we connect with courage, it'll become contagious. I promise you. I will put money on it that if you'll just take a chance at connecting with this local church, if you'll go on the website and there's an Easter, sign up, volunteer for Easter. There are places that you can serve. There's so many things that you can do. I told you there's a place that, you know, that you don't even have to say a word. You can be a parking lot attendant on that day and just say, don't even have to say a word. There's a place for you. But don't just be a part of this local church. Connect with this local church. And what I'm trying to say is this. There may be somebody across the room from you that, you know what? They're going through what you have already gone through. And if you will only have the courage to connect with them, you're going to begin to see the power of God working, because they're going to find out, I'm not the only one who's going through this. And you can begin to tell them and connect with them and say, you're going to get through this. You're going to get through this. You know, I've not had fun laying down the last week and a few days. I don't do that well at all, if you know who I am. My one-year-old likes to be picked up by me. But I'm going to tell you something, what it's caused me to do. Connect with God more than I ever have. Psalms 23 and 2 says, He makes me lie down in green pastures. And He leads me beside the still waters. Church, there are things that you and I are going to go through. And he's going to make us go through some stuff. And if you'll have the courage to connect, just like with the book of Nehemiah, little by little, they connected the wall. Little by little, connect the wall. So I'm going to ask you to pray a little bit differently this morning. I want you to come and I want you to pray. If you're here for the first time this morning, there's a connect card on the in front of the pew behind you. Make sure that you fill that out. Drop it on one of the black boxes with your offerings. Thank you so much for that. We want to connect with you. But I want you to also understand that right now is a unique opportunity for us to connect within generations. Right now, we have an opportunity for us to do exactly what Nehemiah 3 or wherever I was at, 3 or 6 was at. We have an opportunity to come across wherever you are at in your society and title and name in front of your name. We have an opportunity to come across generations and pray one for another. We have an opportunity to connect intentionally starting right now. So what is the March emphasis? There are individual opportunities. There's corporate opportunities. Make sure that you pick those up on your way out and begin to do them. Start today. If there's somebody that you haven't seen, find out if they show up at the 9 o'clock service. Find out if they've not been connected. Take the courage to make the call. Take the courage to send the text. But right now, let's take the courage to connect with God. Would you? Would you find a place to pray? Would you begin to, maybe there's somebody who you know is going through something you want to pray. Maybe right now you want to be courageous enough to go and to introduce yourself to somebody who you don't know. And say, you know, I don't know who you are, but I want to know, because you know what? I want to connect with our PRC family. I want to connect with whatever you're going through. I want to connect with you. We're going to have opportunities to do that this month, but let's get a head start on it. Would you find a place to pray? Would you begin to connect this morning? If it's maybe you need to connect with the courage to say, God, you see what's going on in my life, and you see what's going on in my relationships. You see everything that's going on. So, Father, I ask you to forgive me for my sins. I ask you to help me to connect. And maybe there are others that maybe you don't know. Maybe you need to connect with courage in the situation, the battle that you're in right now. Maybe you need to connect with someone. Would you take the opportunity right now to go and do that? Would you take that opportunity to move? Let's find a place to pray. Let's find a place to pray. Every time, I want you to understand, we're going to have an altar call, because it's a time of consecration. It's a time of consecration. The time that we respond to what the Holy Spirit is speaking in our lives. Listen, there may have been a lot of amens. I don't want you to be a part of the cheering crowd. I want you to be a part of the revival crowd. Don't be willing to just live this life and come to this church the way we have in the past. Let's go. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, we're so thankful for your power. We're so thankful for your anointing, Lord, that is meant for the moment. And we pray, Lord, whether we're watching online or whether we're praying in the altar, Lord, or we're praying in our seat right now, Father, would you empower us to connect with courage in this moment? Would you empower us to connect, Lord, with courage in the midst of adversity? Would you empower us to connect with courage in the midst of celebration? Would you empower us to connect intentionally, Lord? We may feel like we don't have anything to offer, but how will we know unless we connect? How will we know whether we have a connection unless we're willing to put the nail to the board, the rock to the plaster, to rebuild that which you're calling us to rebuild? In the name of Jesus, we make room for you.
Here is where I lay it down, every lie and
this is my surrender. And I will make room for you to do whatever you want to do whatever you want to. And I will make room for you to do whatever you want to do whatever you.
Abednego. I wonder who had the most courage. Because one of the three had enough courage because it became contagious to the other two. You ever thought about that? Somebody had to rise up. Somebody had to take a chance of being thrown in the fire and asking their friends to go with them. But when they did, when they connected with the power of God, they didn't just see the miracle. They saw Jesus. And if you want to see Jesus, start connecting with somebody. If you want to see Jesus, if you want to see Jesus save, if you want to see Jesus sanctify, if you want to see Jesus fill someone with the Holy Spirit, if you want to see Jesus heal somebody, if you want to see Jesus do miracles, we always love to quote that scripture that says, we shall do greater things. You shall do greater things than you've seen me done. And he's saying, you'll see them when you connect with me and other people. You know, when Donna came into the laundromat, it was already past time for us to leave. She came in with an attitude. I knew it was ripe for revival. So it took a little bit longer maybe than what we had anticipated, but you know what happened? Life change. Life change. I don't know who you're going to connect with, but I know that God never makes mistakes. That He was intentional to bring you and bring them here for such a time as this, in this moment. So, who's it going to be? Who's going to be courageous enough to connect intentionally in PRC? Who is it? You may be seated. Let's enjoy. Where's PRC? Thank you. Mr. Mike, thank you so much for creating that, and I challenge you to take the Your Love cards, Your Worth It cards, and wherever you, maybe you go out today, pick up some cards on your way out, and as you leave on the back cabinets back in the back, there are new emphases for March. Put it on your mirror, put it on your refrigerator. There's intentional efforts that we're going to make throughout this month to connect with NPRC. Why? Because we'll never be able to grow beyond what our structural base is. What does that mean? We'll never be able to build more than you are connected within here. Okay? Thank you so much for your willingness to let me sit, dress down,
Some people are saying, do it again. We're going to make intentional efforts to shift to this next generation. Okay? And we're so thankful for you. We're so thankful for your prayers. And again, we love you. You're loved. Okay? Let's stand together as we get ready to leave today. Father, in this past week, we have been privileged to celebrate the life of a newborn baby. We've also seen that life was taken and has been restored by her Creator and Savior. And Father, we're so thankful that in those moments of celebration, in those moments of calamity, that if we find ourselves connected to a local body of believers, that we never go through it alone. So, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would grant us favor today, that you would grant me favor, Lord, amongst those that are online and those that have been present in these two services today. As Nehemiah began to pray, Lord, grant me favor in the presence of the King. God, I pray, Lord, that you would give us favor today, Lord, within this congregation for us to move intentionally and begin to connect intentionally, to make the phone calls. Lord, give us the courage. Give us the courage to make the efforts. Father, as we connect with each other, we'll connect with the power of God. We're so thankful for your prayers. We're so thankful for the power of your Spirit that we felt here today. And so, Father, take that same power and empower us to go forward full of faith, full of strength, full of anointing, full of favor. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. God bless you today as you leave. Enjoy your spring break. There will be no midweek services here this week. However, prayer will continue on Wednesday evenings. Prayer works will continue